Good morning, Gray St. Paul's. I am not Father Steve. Just in case there's any confusion, I am not Father Steve. Father Steve is on holiday through July 10th, and the associates will be supplying over the next couple of weeks. If you are unfamiliar with me, my name is Father Gary. I am the current director of Social Justice Ministry in Action here at Grace St. Paul's. And I am also filling out till December 31st the associate rector's position. So I am on campus Monday, Wednesday, and Fridays. And I am here about every sixth weekend. That is my contract. And I'm also the rector of St. Andrew's in Nogales. So there's a few hats that I'm wearing and juggling, and there are days I wonder what I got myself into. I see some of you are wearing name tags. Congratulations, I didn't get the memo, as you can tell. I'm in the office 3 days a week, and yeah, I got the memo. If you do not have a name tag and would like one, please let the ushers know. If you have already done that, there are name tags in the back for you. Just ask the ushers, they're off on a side table, so that you can pick them up and you can wear them so we get to know each other once again. Otherwise than that, you'll have to stand up here and tell us your name, and just like I did. That'll go over really well. We have a Narcon training session coming up, and it's highly recommended that staff, clergy, and volunteers make every effort possible to attend. That's on July 7th, between the hours of 1 and 2 in McBride Hall. That's not in the bulletin, but it should be in the bulletin. Reminder that we do have a Taze service on July 6th from 5 to 6 here in the chancel. And I believe the topic, where's Reverend Nancy? Oh, is on forgiveness, so please try to Taze, if you haven't been to one, it's really a beautiful service. What? Between 5 to 6 in the afternoon, yeah. And when we say chancel, it's usually up here. All right, so you already know, or just learned, that I'm the Director of Social Justice in Action. I'm told that is the crown jewel of Grace St. Paul's ministry, and I've been at it now for 2 months. And I'm trying to get a 3-month or quarterly snapshot of what is happening. And I want to thank all of you who contribute to the Rector's Discretionary Fund, because that is where a lot of our money goes to. And what you see in the annual report of what is budgeted for that, which is $10,000 a year, is about a third of what it actually costs to run. And we are always running short of things. Dry goods, canned goods have increased in cost. Milk, cereal, the things for our lunch bags all have gone up in cost. And our volunteers, bless their hearts, donate a lot of goods. I'm after them to give me receipts, and they fight me tooth and nail because that's out of the generosity of their heart. The only reason I want that is I want to give you as a parish a good snapshot of what it actually costs to run this ministry. On that note, I need some volunteers. There are 4 components to this ministry. The social service desk, which works for helping folks get IDs and birth certificates and making referrals to different agencies in town. There is the lunch part, where we provide a cold breakfast, hot coffee, hot water, sometimes hot cereal, and a bagged lunch. There is the pantry itself that gives out food bags according to our structure. And we have a shower ministry that we run where the showers are just down the outside steps. On top of that, we have a bread ministry. The bread ministry picks up bread at the Campbell location for Beyond Bread every night. In the mornings, a different crew sorts it and delivers it to various entities in the city for those who need it. That ministry is suffering under a lack of volunteers. We are not so young anymore, some of us. I'd like to think I am, but I'm in the not so young and crowd at the moment. So if you are considering doing that, please talk to me or Sharon McKenzie. Just contact the office and Brooke will get you that information. A couple of people from the 7:45 service, two young couples have already said they're interested in that and they will be shadowing some to see what that ministry is about. The social service desk has not been in operation every day we are open because I don't have enough volunteers. And that is a critical aspect of our ministry, helping people get IDs and birth certificates. And if we aren't doing it, Trinity Church is no longer doing it. I need some volunteers. The front hospitality, where we do the cold breakfast, doing great. The pantry, I only have two volunteers. So if you are considering wanting to give a little bit of your time on one morning a week, once or twice a month, I would be so appreciative. And part of it, you know, all I can impart to all of you is, without volunteers and funds, your crown jewel will not operate. Let me know after the service. I'm trying to do it this method, otherwise I'm going to get my big whip out and go tapping people on shoulders. And I'd rather not do that. But I want to give you a snapshot that one half of my volunteers right now are non-parishioners. Just think about that for a moment. Your crown jewel is functioning with 50% of the volunteers coming from other places. Folks where their churches have stopped doing this ministry, have seen what we do, and are here. So you're going to hear more about that in the coming months, because my ministry is to give as much transparency to all of you about what is happening. Father Steve's already had his eyes opened a little bit. He said, I thought this was a fine running machine. It's a bit chaotic. I'm working with the bookkeeper and the treasurer to get these numbers more accurately in line so we can give you who support this ministry a really good sense of what's going on. And just so you know, over the past 2 months that I have been here, we've gone from serving 70 bag lunches to over 90. There's a lot of need, there's a lot of unhomed people, and they're humans. So, if you don't want me to go tapping you on the shoulder, please volunteer. Okay. The other thing we are doing is we are doing a cooling center in the afternoons, Monday, Wednesday, and Friday from 12:30 to 4 when the temperatures hit 105 or above. Right now, one of our guests who comes for the cold breakfasts, her and her companion want to pay it forward and will be volunteering on those days. We'd like to have two volunteers just to kind of keep an eye on things. We supply water and ice in a quiet, cool place for people to be during that time. If you are interested in doing that, please give Brooke a call in the morning or any time, and we can put you on a volunteer list for that. Like this coming week, we're scheduled to be 111 tomorrow. We will be open between 12:30 and 4. And quite honestly, if you look at the schedule going forward, we're going to be in the triple digits all week, over 105. So there is real need for this ministry. And that's kind of what I oversee. If you ever wondered why I'm here and what I do, that's a quick snapshot. And if there are any questions, I'd be happy to answer them after the service. Any questions? No questions. I see volunteers up here. I see volunteers out there. And thank you, folks, for what you do. Really, really, really important. So let us take a moment of silence as we prepare to worship and pray.
A warm welcome to our online participants this morning. Remember, if you are going to be able to get away and have a bit of a vacation, you can sit in a tent, a hotel room, a car, by a lake, or in a forest. And if you have internet service, you can join our online GSP community at gsptucson.org/live Then afterwards, you can go to gsptucson.org/forum and greet and discuss with your parishioner neighbors. For now, people in the church, turn around and greet our online participants. A warm welcome to all.
Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, wild, boundless spirit of the cosmos. You notice every fledgling leaping courageously from its nest, trusting its as yet untested wings.
You count the very hairs on our heads, reminding us that we are all your beloved children.
As you once saved Hagar and Ishmael from dying of thirst in the desert, hold us now in your infinite embrace.
As we walk with Christ into the newness of life, amen.
May the Holy One be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. God of the impossible, we pray for justice, peace, and reconciliation. When the challenges seem too many, remind us of your resurrection power. When the task seems overwhelming, remind us of the miracle of love. And when disorientation threatens us, reminds us of your vision of a world made whole. Help us to hope that the impossible can happen and live as if it might do so today. Be seated for the readings.
A reading from Genesis. The child grew and was weaned, and Abraham made a great feast on the day that Isaac was weaned. But Sarah saw the son of Hagar the Egyptian, whom she had borne to Abraham, playing with her son Isaac. So she said to Abraham, "Cast out this slave woman with her son, for the son of this slave woman shall not inherit along with my son Isaac." The matter was very distressing to Abraham on account of his son. But God said to Abraham, "Do not be distressed because of the boy and because of your slave woman. Whatever Sarah says to you, do as she tells you. For it is through Isaac that offspring shall be named for you. As for the son of the slave woman, I will make a nation of him also, because he is your offspring." So Abraham rose early in the morning and took bread and a skin of water and gave it to Hagar, putting it on her shoulder along with the child, and sent her away. And she departed and wandered about in the wilderness of Beersheba. When the water in the skin was gone, she cast the child under one of the bushes. Then she went and sat down opposite him a good way off, about the distance of a bow shot. For she said, "Do not let me look on the death of the child." And as she sat opposite him, she lifted up her voice and wept. And God heard the voice of the boy, and the angel of God called Hagar from heaven and said to her, "What troubles you, Hagar? Do not be afraid, for God has heard the voice of the boy where he is. Come, lift up the boy and hold him fast with your hand, for I will make a great nation of him." Then God opened her eyes, and she saw a well of water. She went and filled the skin with water and gave the boy a drink. God was with the boy, and he grew up. He lived in the wilderness and became an expert with the bow. He lived in the wilderness of Paran, and his mother got a wife for him from the land of Egypt. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thank you. The Holy Gospel of our Savior Jesus Christ, according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Christ.
Jesus said to the 12 apostles, "A disciple is not above the teacher, nor a slave above the master. It is enough for the disciple to be like the teacher, and the slave like the master. If they have called the master of the house Beelzebub, how much more will they malign those of his household? So have no fear of them, for nothing is covered up that will not be uncovered, and nothing secret that will not become known. What I say to you in the dark, tell in the light, and what you hear whispered, proclaim from the housetops. Do not fear those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Rather, fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Were not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your Father. And even the hairs of your head are all counted. So do not be afraid. You are of more value than many sparrows. Everyone, therefore, who acknowledges me before others, I also will acknowledge before my Father in heaven. But whoever denies me before others, I also would deny before my Father in heaven. Do not think that I have come to bring peace to the earth. I have not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I've come to set a man against his father, and a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law, and one's foes will be members of one's own household. Whoever loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me, and whoever loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever does not take up the cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Those who find their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it." The Gospel of Jesus Christ.
For those of you who last time I preached on Kermit the Frog challenged me to do Miss Piggy, please be seated. You should know better than challenge me. Be afraid. Be very afraid, seems to be the message this diva of Muppet Land imparts. Either she is happy and exuberant, spewing words in a rather terrible French accent, or she is angry and physically brutal, expressing her dismay through a mangled rendition of a karate chop on whomever her latest displeasure is bestowed. Her character displays very binary thinking, dualistic behavior. It's either or with Miss Piggy, which tells me one thing. She's not an Episcopalian. After all, our denomination is known for its via media, the middle way. Nothing with Miss Piggy suggests she embodies such beliefs or practices. Maybe that's what it means to be a diva if you're female, or a devo if you're male. Now, I hope I can be forgiven for thinking of Miss Piggy and her on-again, off-again companion Kermit as I read today's readings. No, I don't. They do not see Sarah as a diva. but her behavior does confuse me. Earlier in the story, she implores her husband to seek out a female companion, her own servant nonetheless, or more accurately, her own slave woman. For Sarah herself, it seems, is unable to conceive and bear a child of her own, which was paramount in the patriarchal culture of her era. It might be suggested that in the parlance of the 60s and 70s generation, Sarah and Abraham appear to be swingers. Matter of fact, bedchambers in most of Scripture seem to have a revolving door of who's who in their coming and going. So much for those purveyors of marriage between one man and one woman and no copulation before said time. Sarah embodies something quite to the contrary. Needless to say, her slave has a male child, and rather than be happy, she becomes resentful to the point of being jealous of Hagar and her son, eventually desiring their removal from the community. Am I the only one to see that Ishmael and Isaac are actually half siblings? That they share the same father yet have different mothers? Can pride of position cause such disarray within a family system? It seems that pecking order matters, and that causes me a bit more apprehension. Adding to my alarm is a story of Jesus suggesting that family members will be pitted against each other if one is to love anything or anyone more than Jesus, and by extension, God. How does one reconcile these rather capricious stories with a steadfast and loving God? This is not a soft and fluffy Jesus, the teddy bear Jesus, as I like to refer him to. Neither is Sarah being warm and fuzzy and kind-hearted. But if one takes these stories to their illogical conclusion, as so many Christian churches do, then blended families are not just frowned upon. They are anathema to Jesus' message. Really, folks? Is that what we believe? That's just incredulous to me. In the 25 years that I worked as a barber in my family's hair salon, I know firsthand that the typical nuclear family of our past imaginations is just that, a figment of one's imagination. A family is not necessarily composed of one male, one female, 2.3 kids, 3.5 dogs, a suburban home with a white picket fence, where the dutiful spouse brings casserole dishes to the neighbors as acts of kindness. You all do that, right? I really want to see 2.3 kids. That entertains me. I'd love to see that. Reality dictates otherwise and is not restricted to some purity code of yore that never really existed. Secular laws and religious dictates that seek to impose draconian approaches to life are so much less about the Jesus they point to in making their case for such impositions, and so much more about their own moral corruption, their own desire for control of others, their own myopic renderings of both the Elder and Younger Testaments. Their binary thinking is not only unhealthy, it's unsupported by sacred writings, and it's downright cruel. To look at Sarah and Jesus today and utilize an antagonistic approach to life, masquerading said life in the guise of faithful living, is, in my opinion, the true abomination. What many fail to see in these stories and how they impact our lives is that God is not capricious in so much as maybe the writers of the text are, who are being influenced by cultural norms no one ever questions. Why can't Ishmael and Isaac play together as children, as half-brothers who share the common thread of being their father's sons? Why can't a family love God without necessarily causing a rupture to one's relationships? That got me thinking. Interracial marriage has only been legal since 1967. It's been a little over 5.5 decades since that Supreme Court ruling allowing for interracial marriage. I was 5 years old when that ruling occurred, and throughout my life, I have heard people of all stripes complain about its implications. Now bring into the equation same-gendered couples as well as transgender couples, sometimes from different ethnicities, and the minds of the purists just explode. To further amplify this fun explosion, just mention any of the above relationships, having kids, adopting kids, fostering kids, with these various expressions of family, and watch what happens to them. These family traditionalists, and here I'm defining tradition as simply peer pressure from dead people. Think about that for a moment. Isn't that what tradition is? These traditionalists go off on others worse than Miss Piggy ever does in Muppet Land. If this is the moral of these stories we heard today, then I call bull poopy. I really wanted a little icon, emoji icon for that, but I restrained myself. When I read Matthew's passage today and recall last week's reading with where Jesus tells his followers to not go among the Gentiles and Samaritans, an exclusive propaganda mechanism rather than an inclusive one, I am wondering what the H-E double hockey stick was in Matthew's porridge the day he wrote those stories. And by the way, why is Matthew's book the first one in the younger canon when Mark predates it? Most argue it's because the author of Matthew was and is the most Jewish of writings, thus acting like a bridge between the two canons. Placed in this context, then, Matthew is writing to a Jewish household riddled with followers of Jesus who are running into the proverbial family and cultural dynamics of follow the rules. This is how things are done here. None of you have ever used that line, have you? Some of us know folks like this, as they often appear at every holiday family gathering. As such, Matthew isn't implying that you must divorce your family in so much as warning one that to follow Jesus will cause dismay amongst friend and family, for it disrupts the accepted norms most folks adhere to. And they do so often without question. Matthew's argument isn't about who's in and who's out. Rather, it occurs within the context of an internal religious community seeking to grow and expand its ideology, one expressed in Jesus' own willingness to traverse norms and limits. It gives voice to an ongoing argument within family traditions, denominations, and parishes about how to live into the good news, or even how one describes said good news. Beloved, if there is a moral to these stories, it's not God favoring some at the expense of others. It's that God did not abandon Hagar or her child Ishmael, nor did God abandon Sarah and Isaac. Even in Matthew's gospel, hard as this may seem, God is with those whom followers of Jesus must separate themselves from. That's a bit of a hard pill for me to swallow. Though I disagree vehemently with some of my Christian siblings and their understanding of the good news and how best to follow Jesus, though I think they are wrong just as much as they think I am wrong, I realize that they too are children of God, and as such, God does not abandon them in their own spiritual journey. We culturally and religiously want to separate ourselves according to ideology and codes of conduct that favor one over the other. We adhere to said codes without question. And my iPads are not my friend. God did not show partiality to Isaac or Ishmael. Nor does God desire that we take up swords within our families as an act of purification. Using scripture in selective ways misses the point. It fails to see the larger picture. We are not called to cower under our desks as Kermit and companions do when the tempest of exclusivity flails around us. We are called to stand and face the fury without judgment or condemnation, knowing that God is with all of us, foe and friend, striving to build the kingdom of justice and peace. We are invited to seek the via media, knowing that God's blessing is with all creation and not just those parts we agree with. That is the real challenge here, that even those we call enemy are beloved of God, for God shows no partiality. That is the difficult truth we are confronted with today, a truth that discomforts both the conservative and the progressive alike. And that, beloved, is really good news. It is not for the faint of heart, but for the disciple willing to trust that there is a better way than our human tendencies to separate and divide, rather than seek the middle way of understanding. May each of us, after a little self-reflection, seek that via media and recognize that God is all in all. Do not be afraid, beloved, for God is with us regardless of our varied stances and ideologies. Amen.
Let us say together an affirmation of faith from a We Worship book on page 11. We believe in God,
who befriended a wandering people, calling them from slavery into freedom, yet who in Sarah, Abraham, Ishmael, Hagar, Ruth, Bathsheba, and many others called outsiders to be agents of God's purpose.
We believe in Jesus,
who was revered by the Persian sages, sought and found asylum in Egypt, preached the love of God to Syrians, attracted Greeks to his cause, found his incomprehensible faith in a Roman, had his cross shouldered by a Libyan, and ascended above his native land that he might be present in all places.
We believe in the Holy Spirit,
who at Pentecost proved that heaven has no favored mother tongue, who in the baptism of an Egyptian denied racism foothold in faith, and who in the ancient and modern worlds founded churches in different cultures.
We believe that God is supremely known in Jesus.
Yet we affirm that God is present among people who do not claim Christ as their own.
We believe that the commonwealth of God is bigger than the church, and that the love of God is beyond our understanding.
Therefore, we celebrate that God's ways are not our ways, that God knows whom God chooses, and reserves the right to surpass all human expectation. Blessed be to God forever. Amen.
God of all that is good, in Scripture you give us your vision of the world. In love you give us your grace. In wisdom you give us each other. Through the vision of your Spirit, we learn that your very hope is that we be your presence, your power, and your body in the world. For this we give you thanks, and as one body, offer ourselves and each other as we pray. We pray for every community of faith. This week, we especially pray for women pastors in the Southern Baptist Church.
God, unites us all.
Blessed be your Holy Spirit. God of justice and truth, we pray for our nation. This week, we pray that the movement for a 28th amendment to the U.S. Constitution, including a civilian ban on assault weapons, will gain traction.
God, he calls us to justice and forgives us.
Open our hearts to receive your truth.
Help us reach out to the world. This week we pray for the safety and dignity of LGBTQ plus people around the world.
God, who makes power of powerlessness,
make us justice and peace.
We pray for those who suffer.
God, who enfolds us in your own wounds,
open our hearts to the healing power of your love.
We pray for those who have died, including B.J. Bauer and Mary Fitzgerald.
God of forever and from before time,
we praise you for the wonder of eternal life.
We thank you for the blessings and surprises of life. This week, we give thanks to GSP parishioners for financially sponsoring our children to go to camp at Chapel Rock.
God of all blessings,
we give you our thanks and praise.
God of truth uncovered, you trace the sparrow's flight and plumb the secret places of the heart. Bring our fear and conflict into the light of your presence. Help us to lose our hollow life and find our way to you through Jesus the Christ, the Master and the Slave.
Amen.
Holy One, your words cause us to tremble. Nothing is covered up that will not be uncovered, and nothing secret that will not be known.
God of all, there is much in our lives that we wish to hide from others, even ourselves. We fear those who kill the body while ignoring those who kill the soul. Teach us once more, O God, that your Son came to bring us all life, even if he turned against father and daughter against mother. Remind us of our higher calling and the promises you offer of life in your realm, which has no end. Amen.
Those who seek to preserve their life will lose it, but those who lose their life for Christ's sake will find it. Lose your life, beloved, and receive the blessing of the God of the impossible, the God of hope, and the God of the boundless spirit.
Amen.
Beloved, the peace of Christ be always with you. So then, whenever we have an opportunity, let us work for the good of all.
Why should I feel?
Giver of life, receive all we offer you this day.
Let the Spirit you bestow on your church continue to work in the world through the hearts of all. Amen.
God is with us.
God is present here.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift our hearts to the Most High.
Let us give thanks to the Holy One.
It is right to offer thanks and praise.
Living God, your word speaks in the void, calling into being things that are not, inviting us to share your work of creation. We thank you for the ages long of gathering stars and cooling earth, of life evolving and waking eyes of wonder. We thank you for the creatures with whom we share the world, for their lives so different from our own and the richness they reveal. We thank you for the Son of Man, formed from Mary's flesh and nurtured by her faith. He walked the growing earth and proclaimed a fearless kingdom of bird and lily, child and stranger, the beggar and the blind. On the cross, he joined the labor of all creation's yearning. In his rising, he hallowed all flesh to bear the glory of God. He gives the brooding spirit to bring to birth a living hope. Therefore, with all that has life through him, with animals and angels, and all who hope for a new creation, we share the song of love which sounds from all eternity. We ask that your Holy Spirit fall upon us and upon these gifts, that these fragile earthly things may be to us the body and blood of our brother, Jesus the Christ, who on the night he was betrayed, gathering with his faltering friends for a meal that tasted of freedom, calling them to this table, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, Jesus took the cup, saying, "This cup is new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it to remember me."
Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died.
Christ is risen. Christ fills all creation.
Therefore, we come to him in whom all is created, in heaven and on earth, whose cross and resurrection make all things new.
We offer this to you, asking you to smile upon the gifts we bring, for you alone are the giver, and Christ the gift through which we live once and for all.
Through him who is emptied to bear your fullness, we make our prayer with Paul, Isabel Florence, Hap Good, Cornelius Hill, Irenaeus, Harriet Beecher Stowe, and all created life to the glory of God, who fills all in all, now and forever.
Amen. Padre nuestro, que estás en el cielo, santificado sea tu nombre, venga tu reino, hágase tu voluntad, en la tierra como en el cielo. Danos hoy nuestro pan de cada día, perdona nuestras ofensas, como también nosotros perdonamos a los que nos ofenden. No nos dejes caer en tentación, y líbranos del mal, porque tuyo es el reino, tuyo es el poder, y tuya es la gloria, ahora y por siempre. Amén.
Be known to us, risen Christ, in the breaking of the bread.
Alleluia. The bread which we break makes all of us one with you. Alleluia.
These are the gifts of God for you, the holy people of God. The bread of heaven is broken for the life of this world, so come, you who have much faith, you who would like to have more, you who have been to this table often and you coming for the first time, you who have tried to follow Jesus and you who have failed. For this is the body of Christ, for you, the body of Christ. Behold what you are, become what you receive, come and be nourished. Please stand as you are able and let us recite the post-communion together, found on page 29. Let us pray. We bring swords that you turn into plowshares. We bring expectations of peace, and you meet us with swords. Thank you, God, for showing us the other way. Amen. Though we continue to see people of color cast aside like Hagar and Ishmael,
we will follow your lead and restore their futures.
Though we continue to see people of color banished from society,
we will follow your lead and bless them with opportunities for full life.
Go, therefore, with the blessing of the Eternal One, who loves us all fiercely.
We go to share God's bounty with the world. Amen.
Go forth into the world rejoicing in the power of the Spirit. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.